Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the evening prayer on this Holy Tuesday. It's lovely to be with you this evening. My name is Reverend Dr. Karen Aitzinger, and with me I have Reverend Margie Fisser, who will be assisting me with tonight's service.
Good evening.
So we begin with the introduction. In the name of God, the blessed and holy Trinity.
Amen.
We have come together as the family of God in our God's presence to offer praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive the holy word, to bring before God the needs of the world, to ask forgiveness of our sins, and to seek grace that through the Son, Jesus Christ, we may give ourselves to God's service. We come now to a time of praise. Christ our Lord became obedient even to death.
Let us worship and praise God.
Lord, open our lips,
that we may glorify and praise your name.
Glory to God, source of all being, eternal Word, and Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
We say, come bless the Lord together. Come bless the Lord, all you servants of the Lord, you who by night stand in the house of our God. Lift up your hands towards the holy place and bless the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion, the Lord who made heaven and earth. The time of penitence. Let us call to mind and confess our sins. Almighty God, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you through our own fault, in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. And so may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We move on now to the Word of God, and we begin by saying Psalm 94. O Lord God, to whom vengeance belongs,
O God, to whom vengeance belongs, shine out in glory.
Arise, judge of the earth,
and requite the proud as they deserve.
Lord, how long shall the wicked?
How long shall the wicked triumph?
How long shall all evildoers pour out words?
How long shall they boast and flaunt themselves?
They crush your people, O Lord.
They oppress your own possession.
They murder the widow and the alien.
They put the fatherless to death.
And they say, the Lord does not see.
Nor does the God of Jacob consider it.
Consider this, you senseless among the people.
Fools, when will you understand?
He who planted the ear, does he not hear?
He who formed the eye, does he not see?
He who disciplines the nations, will he not punish?
Has the teacher of the world no knowledge?
The Lord knows human thoughts.
He knows that they are mere breath.
Blessed are those whom you discipline, O Lord,
and teach from your law,
giving them rest from days of misery,
till a pit is dug for the wicked.
The Lord will not cast off his people,
nor will he forsake his own.
For justice shall return to the righteous,
and with them to all the true of heart.
Who will stand up for me against the wicked?
Who will take my part against the evildoers?
If the Lord had not been my helper,
I would soon have dwelt in the land of silence.
But when I said, my foot has slipped,
your mercy, O Lord, was holding me.
In all the doubts of my heart,
your consolations delighted my soul.
Will you be any friend to the court of wickedness
that contrives evil by means of law?
They band together against the life of the righteous
and condemn innocent blood.
But the Lord is my stronghold.
My God is my rock and my refuge.
Let him requite them for their wickedness and silence them for their evil.
The Lord our God shall silence them. The first lesson is written in the book of Lamentations, chapter 1, verses 17 to 22. Zion stretches out her hands, but there is no one to comfort her. The Lord has commanded against Jacob that his neighbors should become his foes. Jerusalem has become a filthy thing among them. The Lord is in the right, for I have rebelled against his word. But hear, all you peoples, and behold my suffering. My young women and young men have gone into captivity. I called to my lovers, but they deceived me. My priests and elders perished in the city while seeking food to revive their strength. See, O Lord, how distressed I am. My stomach churns, my heart is wrung within me, because I have been very rebellious. In the street the sword bereaves, in the house it is like death. They heard how I was groaning, with no one to comfort me. All my enemies heard of my trouble, and they are glad that you have done it. Bring on the day you have announced, and let them be as I am. Let all their evil doing come before you, and deal with them as you have dealt with me, because of all my transgressions, for my groans are many. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We're going to now say Canticle number 13, Christ the Servant. Jesus Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, no guile was found on his lips. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but trusted in him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were straying like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and the guardian of your souls.
Our second lesson is from the Gospel of St. John, chapter 12, and beginning at the 20th verse. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor." This is the Gospel of Christ.
Praise to Christ our Lord. Now may I speak to you in the name of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Giver of life. Holy Week is also known as Passion Week or Passion Tide, because during this time we place our focus on Jesus walking the painful way of the cross to his death. And specifically in our reading from John's Gospel this evening, we find Jesus discussing the meaning of his upcoming death and resurrection with his disciples. And we need to understand that in John's Gospel, the whole point of Jesus' mission as the Christ is to glorify God. And for this reason, in his discussion with his disciples regarding his death, Jesus makes it clear that his destiny is inevitably to walk the way of the cross. Because part of glorifying God is to walk the way of the cross so that the glory of salvation can result. And Jesus says further that if we as his disciples are serious about following him, then we too must inevitably walk the sacrificial way of the cross in our own lives so that we too may glorify God and share more fully in the life of salvation that he has won for us. So how exactly do we walk the way of the cross? Let's unpack this a little further. To help us understand, Jesus uses the idea of a single grain of wheat having to fall to the ground and die, and only then being able to multiply. And what Jesus is emphasizing here is that some kind of death is necessary for further life. Because you see, Jesus knows that as human beings, we have a natural tendency to live out of what Richard Rohr calls the small self or the selfish self. And when we live like this, we tend to be more focused on the growth of our own ego as opposed to being focused on the welfare of others. And yet, we also have the capacity to live out of what Richard Rohr calls the larger self or the true self or the God-centered self. But in order for this transformation to happen, we have to be prepared to painfully sacrifice our small self before the true, more generous self can emerge, which is really what kingdom living is all about. We have to be prepared for continual little dyings along the path of our lives, upon the path of our life's journey, in order to rise again to new and abundant life. This is our purpose and our calling. This is what walking the way of the cross is all about. And it is made possible for us only through the grace of God. This evening we witness Jesus our Savior through the painful pattern of his own life's journey, graciously showing us the path to newness of life that he has won for us. His destiny was to walk the way of the cross literally as he suffered and died and rose again for us. And tonight, although our calling may not be to literally die on a cross, it is about embracing the blueprint of Jesus' life. And of course, this is never easy, although it does also bring the truest and deepest of joy. It requires prayer and discipline and perseverance and self-denial and trying again and again and again and going against our natural human inclination to live the egoic life. And instead, to be willing to undergo a gracious transformation of heart that will recenter us in the life and value system of the kingdom. Because this kingdom life is a generous outreach. It entails a life of generous outreach for the good of community and the planet. And that is our calling. You see, kingdom life is all about loving relationship and sharing, as is demonstrated in the very nature of our Trinitarian God. We have there for us our Trinitarian God as an example to us of living the higher life, the kingdom life, the resurrected life, the life of loving, generous, sharing, and community. And our theme throughout this Lent has revolved around Christian hospitality, which in a nutshell is about generosity towards others. And of course, in the context of the cross, Christian hospitality revolves around Jesus' amazing generosity as he walks the painful path that leads to our salvation. And so, in ending, in a world that is in need of so much redemption and love and generosity and support, may we, this Passion Tide, be strengthened and blessed to walk this self-same way of the cross for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. We're now going to move on to have our first hymn of the evening, Only by Grace.
Oh,
We move on now to say the baptismal creed together. I believe and trust in God, the Creator, who made the world. I believe and trust in the Son, Jesus Christ, who redeemed humankind. I believe and trust in the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God. I believe and trust in one God, the blessed and holy Trinity. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We move on now to say the Lord's Prayer together, and please feel free to say this prayer in the language of your choice. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And so let us pray. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that this evening you show us most poignantly the way of the cross, which leads to the gift of eternal life. And we pray that we too may be strengthened through the power of your Holy Spirit to embrace this path for our own lives. We pray that this path may be a way that the world follows, because only as we live in this way is generous sharing and the values of the kingdom possible in a world of such need, such lack, such pain, such destruction, such brokenness. Thank you for the promise that comes to us at the end of this week, as we celebrate the victory of your resurrection and the manifestation of your kingdom in this world already. May we share in the hope of your kingdom by following you, by following the blueprint you leave us as a path to real life. Amen.
Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, as we look to you as our role model, help us to see what it is that you are calling us to do. Help us to faithfully do our part in building your kingdom. Guide us by your wise spirit and carry us in your grace. We look to you, Lord Jesus Christ, for guidance and for strength. We ask this for ourselves, and we ask your blessing upon us and upon our families and loved ones, and for all who seek your peace and in their own way try to bring kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. And especially at this time, we pray for those who are broken, who are suffering, who are depressed, those who have not been reached out to, but are lonely, And we pray for your Spirit to prompt many millions across the world to have a change of heart. Lord, may this be a time for your Spirit to truly take hold, this time of COVID when the world is vulnerable and maybe more open to you and to listening because they are desperate. May this be a time when we obey your leading, your path. We pray this in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
We move on now to say the collect of the week. True and humble King, hailed by the crowd as Messiah, grant us the faith to know you and love you, that we may be found beside you on the way to the cross, which is the path of glory. For you live and reign in the unity of the Holy Trinity, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen. I'm going to ask Margie to say the collect of peace for us.
Eternal God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works proceed, give your servants that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and that free from the fear of our enemies, we may pass our time in rest and quietness. Through the merits of Jesus Christ our Saviour. Amen.
Amen. Our evening collect. Lighten our darkness, Lord, and by your great mercy defend us in all perils and dangers of the night. For the love of your only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Preserve us, Lord, while waking, and guard us while sleeping, that awake we may watch with Christ, and asleep we may rest in peace. Amen. We now move on to have our second hymn, Humble Thyself.
Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord.
And now to end, we'll say the grace together, after which I will pronounce the final blessing. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all forever. Amen. And now may Christ, who out of defeat brings new hope and new alternatives, bring you new life. And the blessing of God, our Creator, our Redeemer and Sustainer, be with you and all those you love and care for and pray for, now and always. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us this evening.